Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's weekly worship podcast. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following contemporary worship service was recorded on Sunday, October 9th, 2016, at our 11 o'clock service. The sermon was delivered by Pastor Bill Pavuk. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
Welcome to our worship this morning. I want to start out, first of all, thank you to any and all who were here yesterday morning. We did our fall cleanup, getting the grounds, getting the building ready, transitioning things for winter, and doing all of that prepping. And I'd imagine a little bit of extra work, because of course we've had construction and things going on, and who knows how that may have affected things as well. But thank you to everyone that helped with that. A reminder that this afternoon at 3 o'clock, we will have our annual blessing of the animal service out on the south lawn of the church, and all are welcome to come to that. Bring your animals with you, dogs, cats, turtles, lizards, hamsters, whatever. Bring them, and we will offer a blessing, as this is the time of year when we remember St. Francis, who was the patron saint of animals. And so we rejoice at having the opportunity to take those creatures that are such a big part of our lives and such a big part of our homes, and that, you know, as I shared with the preschoolers earlier this week, we never get to worship with them except this one day. So please, please take the time to join us this afternoon at 3 o'clock. Please keep in your prayers also those hospitalized this past week, including Christy Lepler, Bonnie McGovern, Leonard Schwieger, and Kelly Lamb. In addition, our prayers and our condolences go out to Vicki Madsen at the death of Vicki's sister, Valjean, earlier this week. And our prayers of celebration and thanksgiving with Adam and Tammy Valencia. Tammy gave birth to number 6, I believe, with their group of children. Their 6th child, Graciela Ardi Valencia. So we're happy for them, and mom and baby are doing great. In fact, I went to see Tammy in the hospital, and she answered the door. She's up and dressed and was probably the most awake and alive person in the room, which doesn't usually work out that way when I get called to the second floor. So, and with that, I invite you to stand as we sing. Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Holy God, in this precious hour we pause
and gather to hear your word.
To do so, we break from our work responsibilities.
And from our daily duties.
We move from our fears that overwhelm. Free us in these moments from every distraction,
that we may
hear.
Mercy.
invite the congregation to be seated and invite the children to come forward for some time with them. Hi. Come on down. You guys are too far away. Come on, make like a circle. Huddle. We'll huddle. We'll make a huddle today. No, don't scoot. Just, there's a spot there. There's a spot over here and over here. Come on, Nolan. Come on, Dakota. Come on. There we go. Yes. Yeah, and we're going to bring him closer. Ah. What do you mean? Ah. Ah. Oh, that is so sweet. Did you hear that, Dakota? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I heard that.
Well,
that's a good question. What is with the chocolate cake? It looks amazing, doesn't it? In fact, not only does it look amazing, it is called the most amazing chocolate cake. I brought yummy is right. I brought those with me. I brought these with me because these are recipes. These are instructions for making something awesome happen, like this chocolate cake. Or, look at that. Ooh. Ah. Yeah. It's a special kind of chicken. Now, recipes are instructions. Recipes are instructions for making things, right? Recipes are instructions for making things. Now, I've noticed something about recipes. It seems to me that there are two kinds of people. There are two kinds of people when it comes to recipes. Now, some people, they get the recipe and they follow everything exactly and they make sure that they're not off even by this much. They measure close and they make sure that they follow it exactly as it says. And when they do that, I guess things come out the way that they're supposed to. But there's other people that do something different with recipes. Some people look at recipes and they go, I'm going to add more of this. I'm going to have less of that. I'm going to switch this. I'm going to put something else in here. Some people look at this and they say, well, this says bell peppers. I want zucchini in there. So I'm going to take out the bell peppers and put in the zucchini. And this says, and this says cloves. I don't like cloves, so I'm not going to put cloves in there. So, you know, sometimes people play with the recipes. And sometimes that works out great, too. Sometimes it doesn't work out so great. Like this chocolate cake. It says 3 cups of sugar and 1.5 teaspoons of salt.
That is not right.
Well, that's what it says. I don't know.
3 cups, but that's the size of cake.
What? No, it's a whole cake. It's a great big cake. It's not just the slice. That does seem like a lot of sugar, though, doesn't it? Yeah. Maybe it's the frosting. I don't know. But what if we flipped it and instead of 3 cups of sugar, we put in 3 cups of salt?
Ew. Yeah.
Suddenly it becomes the most disgusting chocolate cake. Right.
And it might taste gross.
Or what if instead of bell pepper in the chicken, we put in 1 cup of cinnamon?
Ew.
Ew. Yeah. Probably. Probably not a good thing. Probably not a good thing. So following the instructions.
Kind of like God, you have to follow the
way. Right. Following the instructions is important. Now, in our Bible story today, God gave some instructions to somebody. There was a man. Broccoli would make it taste gross. Especially the cake. Yeah. Okay. In the story today, in the Bible story. Anita, quiet. In the Bible story today, there's a man who was very powerful, but he was also very sick. He was very sick, and he needed help. And God gave him some really simple instructions. The directions for this, it goes on for like a whole page, and it's really small print. That's a lot of things to remember. God told him to do one thing. God told him to do one thing, but he took God's recipe and God's instructions and said, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I want to do something else. But fortunately, some friends of his said, why don't you follow the recipe? Because he only told you to do one thing. And fortunately, he does follow the recipe. He does follow the recipe. He doesn't change it. And things turned out well for him. Now, God gives us instructions and directions to follow every... Yep, yes, he is. God gives us instructions and directions to follow every day. God gives us instructions and directions to follow every day. And if we follow those directions and instructions, we know things are going to work out for us. If we don't, it's kind of like playing with the cake recipe. Maybe it's going to work out, but maybe not. Maybe it's not something that we should mess around with. Maybe if we follow God's instructions and if we listen to God's plans and look for God's path, things work out. All right. Let's pray together. Lord God, you have a plan. You direct our lives. Help us to listen. Help us to receive. Help us to follow as best as we can the word that you give. Amen. All right. Thank you for coming up. Our worship continues with our readings.
A reading from the 2 Kings. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man and in high favor with his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man, though a mighty warrior, suffered from leprosy. Now the Arameans, on one of their raids, had taken a young girl captive from the land of Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to give death or life, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Just look and see how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me." But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king. "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go. Wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean." But Naaman became angry and went away, saying, "I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned and went away in rage. But his servants approached and said to him, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more when all he said to you was wash and be clean?" So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. Then he returned to the man of God, he and all his company. He came and stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalmody. Hallelujah. I give thanks to God with everything I've got. Splendor and beauty mark his craft. His generosity never gives out. He gave food to those who fear him. He remembered to keep his ancient promise. He manufactures truth and justice. All his products are guaranteed to last, never out of date, never obsolete, rust-proof. He's so personal and holy, worthy of our respect. The good life begins in the fear of God.
A reading from Paul's second letter to Timothy. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. That is my gospel, for which I suffer hardship, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, so that they may also obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is sure. If we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of this and warn them before God that they are to avoid wrangling over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by him, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite the congregation to stand for the reading of our gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. Luke in the 17th chapter. Now on the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back. Praising God with a loud voice, he prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. This one was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up. Go on your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Congregation, may be seated. The peace of the Lord be with you all. There's an old story that I don't remember exactly word for word, but it goes something like this. Family is driving home from church, and the parents turn to little Bobby, 7 years old, and they ask him what they talked about in Sunday school that day. Bobby says, "Well, we learned about Moses freeing the Israelites from slavery." So the parents said, "Well, tell us what happened. Tell us what you learned." Bobby says, "Well, first God sent in the Air Force, and they fired bombs and missiles at the Egyptians to eliminate all of their weapons. And then Moses called in troops to shut down the roads so the Egyptians couldn't get any assistance from the neighbors. And then they sent in Navy SEALs and Marines to take down the palace guard and set the slaves free. And then they drove in like 1,000 trucks to load up all of the people and get all of their things. And they drove them out to the coastline. And God sent an aircraft carrier over to pick them up. And they put the people on the aircraft carrier to take them over to the other side of the sea. Dad pulls the car over, and they turn around, and they said, "That's what they taught you. That's what Mrs. Ramirez told you in Sunday school." And Bobby said, "Well, no, not exactly. She told this story about God giving the Egyptians all of these chances, and there were frogs and these things called plagues, and then the people got free by doing something with lamb's blood, and then somebody put a stick in the ground and the water went away, but that sounded too crazy to me." The story, I share the story because it speaks to a tendency that we have, a tendency, a desire even, often in our lives, to envision or even to impose on God that God will receive, that God will react, that God will respond in the ways that we're customary with, in the ways that we're familiar with. In the first reading, the story from 2 Kings, Naaman goes looking for help. He goes to the prophet, and we see his demeanor go from being hopeful and gracious to being outraged and offended. Elisha, the prophet, farms out the work of healing his leprosy to a subordinate. Now, Naaman seeks out the prophet, and it tells us that he's a man of tremendous authority. He's a great leader, someone of great stature. And he's looking forward. He's looking forward to standing face to face with this person that he probably imagines has similar powers and similar authority. He's looking forward to seeing the person that's going to restore wholeness to him. And he's probably looking forward to witnessing, I don't know, something amazing, something majestic, something powerful, a dread illness like leprosy. To heal that, it's got to take something massive, something huge. Maybe he's even heard tall tales of others being healed through complicated rituals and ceremonies. He expects something incredible. He expects to see great power and authority on display to deliver him from this dread illness. And he probably goes ready to prove himself and his worth if he needs to. Doesn't say so in the scriptures, but I'm guessing that Naaman probably traveled with some treasure, some compensation to give to the prophet, and also ready to prove himself by a feat of strength, a display of devotion, a sacrifice. You know, he goes ready for some quid pro quo, some I give you this, you give me that. And he's offended. He's offended when he's told to go and wash in a very common and fairly dirty little river. He doesn't get holy water from a sacred place. He doesn't get expensive ointments prepared at great cost. Now, fortunately, others implore him to suck it up and to go wade in the blasted river and be grateful that it's not going to cost him any more than that. And even more fortunately, he listens. But Naaman's reluctance mirrors some of the struggles that we see around us, some of the struggles that we encounter, that we're witness to. Struggles to really take God's grace for what it is. Instead of imposing on ourselves or imposing on others, that grace is a gift, but it works better if we've met it halfway. This gets expressed in a lot of different ways, from humanity's ongoing attachment to karma, you know, what goes around comes around, which is something that is so so elegantly and profoundly fair. It really, really is. That we expect it almost more often than we expect to see grace being shown. It gets expressed in our discomfort with receiving what can't be repaid. And it gets expressed in the compulsion that we sometimes find in people to create our own system of penance and our own system of punishment where none of that is being asked of us by anyone. In the video resource for our first communion instruction, the children meet a couple of young adults named Jacob and Julie. Now, Jacob's a bit of a science geek, and we see him in the videos, and he's tinkering around, he's mixing chemicals and pouring things together and doing experiments and testing hypotheses throughout the videos. So when Jacob gets invited to the Lord's table, Julie finds him engineering a several hundred pound tomato so that he can share it with the Lord. Julie assures him that it's really not necessary, that all God needs of him is to come and receive. But Jacob expresses a thought that is pretty common and pretty human. Jacob says, "Yeah, I get it, but don't you think he'd like me a little bit more if I brought the tomato?" And it's natural to think that way. And to give us some credit, it's good to a point to think that way. Because it's good to want to help. It's good to want to contribute. It's good to want to add something to the great things that God is giving to us. But tied up with those kinds of sentiments is us having a hard time accepting the fact that God's economy, how God manages God's household, can be very, very different from ours. It's not always as dramatic as we want it to be. It doesn't have the retribution that we might want to see. Instead, in the economy of love that God recognizes, we have a God who has an eternal memory when it comes to the things that we quickly forget. And at the same time, a God who has zero recall at all when it comes to other things that we can never get out of our heads. Specifically, the sins that we commit and the sins that are done unto us. And like Naaman, the restoration that God offers can sometimes leave us feeling uncertain or unconvinced. It leaves us thinking to ourselves, could a gesture like that really accomplish all of that? Surely God needs to do more than that. And as I said earlier, it's a noble and a righteous and a God-honoring thing to be deliberate and sincere and dedicated in our response to what God has graced us with. In fact, the kingdom is counting on those sorts of responses from us. But it's not how or why God steps in and acts as he does when he gives us what seems too good to be true. And in relationship to those hurdles, those artificial hurdles and stumbling blocks and penance that we make for ourselves sometimes, I have an old friend, very close, very dear friend. We've been a part of each other's lives for about 30 years, whom I love very much. And she is one of the most generous and gentle and patient and forgiving people that I've ever known towards other people. There's nothing that she won't do for her family. There's nothing that she won't do for her friends. There's little that she won't do for strangers. But when it comes to her own failings, when it comes to her mistakes and her choices, there isn't the same kind of grace and understanding. When it comes to God's mercy and peace for her, she continues to struggle to accept that it could ever really be enough, that she could really be enough. She knows what is promised, but feels more secure. She feels more secure if she can create some penance, if she can make some restitution, if she can point to something else, if she can point to some punishment that she can create in her own mind to make sure that she's truly covered. And again, there's a part of that that we can understand, because we want people to own things, we want people to be responsible for things. But when it keeps people from fully trusting, fully turning things over, fully laying down their burdens, really accepting the yoke of Christ, then there's a problem. And I think there's a little bit of Naaman's sensibility in a lot of us. And God would have us be mindful of it. God would have us be mindful of it, not so that we can go out and beat ourselves up over it, but so that we can move past it. So that we can move past it as Naaman did. So that we can take on the vulnerability of really trusting God's answer to our needs as being enough. Peace be with you. Amen.
Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love you.
Set free by the truth of God's gracious love, we pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation. Our intercessory response is, your mercy is great. O God, we pray for the church on earth. Make us one in spirit, whatever our denominational label may be, whatever our practice, however we may worship, make us one. Hear us, O God. We pray for the health of the life-giving waters of creation, and we give you thanks for the great water resources you have given our own state. We pray, help us to be good stewards of this gift, to guard them from misuse and pollution. We remember, too, the destructive power of water. We pray for the people of Haiti and the Atlantic seaboard of our own nation as they recover, rebuild from a devastation hurricane. Hear us, O God. We pray for leaders in our town, our region, our country, and across the globe. Equip them to work for justice and peace for all people. Hear us, O God. We pray for those who are sick or in pain. May your healing hand be upon them, especially those we name in our hearts before you. Hear us, O God. We pray for this assembly during our journey to financial peace. Make us wise stewards of the money you give us. Help us from foolish decisions. Give us hope in the midst of the things that we deal with financially. Hear us, O God. We give thanks for the faithful departed, and we wait for the day when we join them in thanks and praise around your heavenly throne. Hear us, O God. Into your hands, faithful God, we place ourselves and our prayers, spoken and unspoken, trusting in your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share this gift of peace. Christ's peace. Thank you. Before we stand for the Great Thanksgiving, I just want to share an update on our Momentum ministry. We are at the halfway point in the Legacy Journey class and also in Financial Peace University. I usually get excited, and I think the teachers might also be experiencing this. About the halfway point is usually when we as teachers in Financial Peace University, Legacy Journey, really start seeing big smiles on the faces of the people in the class, because suddenly they're realizing, you know, we think we can do this. And they discover a lot of particular ways in which to address the financial circumstances within their life. Also, with our Momentum journey is a very special focus on learning to manage money wisely. And for just about every one of us, that means, gee, I got to tend to certain things in my backyard, like weeds and things like that, that I need to tend to in my life. One of the big lessons of this past week was on dumping debt. I do hope you'll take the journey handout that was given to you and take some time with it. It brought tears to my eyes as I was doing the totals, but I also am a person of great hope. We estimate that the total indebtedness of our congregation for non-mortgage debt is over $10 million. Did you hear what I said? Over $10 million for items that have fleeting value. We're not talking about mortgages that are with homes that build value. We're talking about our standard of life and the way we have spent money and found ourselves getting caught in debt traps, over $10 million probably. And we base that on what we discover each time we do Financial Peace University, about 900,000 in the 21 households that are in Financial Peace University, 21 households represented there. It matches perfectly what we see in the American family. If you look at the national statistics for the typical American household, our debt ratio that we're seeing in class, multiplied through the church and across the country, reflects the figures that I just shared with you. That just is a great burden to be thinking about. There is also hope. And the hope I saw also in the classes this week, people as they were talking in class on how they were going to address particular debt situations in their own life, listening to Dave Ramsey and sharing words of encouragement, they were laughing. I think lesson 4 has more laughter than any of the other classes. Teachers probably experience that, right? Nancy Chavez probably has people next door in a home wondering, what are they laughing about? She's in my class. I can say that, can I, Nancy? Thank you. But why do we laugh? And what is the hope and encouragement? It is because we know we have it in our capacity and with the gifts of God to address these things in some very wise, positive, constructive ways. I'm going to lift a Balcom family here. They're going on Thursday, driving into the night to Franklin, Tennessee, just on the south edge of Nashville. It's fall break, and they're taking the whole family. And what are you going to do? We're going to do a debt-free shout. If you There are others in our church, too, that I know have worked the program and are living debt-free. Nancy, can I mention you again? Nancy discovered, wow, I didn't realize I could be debt-free. I had it in my power already within the class to do that. She's got a big smile on her face because it's like, whew, man, that empowers me. It empowers her to do some things now that she didn't realize was in her power. Balcom family is going to be on the Ramsey radio show. I'm not quite sure. You said third hour, and it's the 3 o'clock to 4 o'clock hour. You can check out. We're going to put it on Facebook, the different radio stations that carry it, different times. And so we'll get to listen in. And you got to get the boys to really shout loud with you, okay? Okay, we're practicing. Good. They do that in the studio. I watched them do it when I was there a year ago for training. It's a great experience. And we want to congratulate you on putting the lessons to good use. Paid off over $40,000 in 14 months. Can be done. It can be done. So congratulations.
Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, you alone are holy. You alone are God. The universe declares your praise beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath. Generations bless your faithfulness. Through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future. We give you thanks for your dear Son at the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people, throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit, in your church, without end. Amen. We join with one another as a family of faith as we pray in the words that our Savior taught. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Be seated. Let us take hold of the life that really is life. Let us come and take our place at the table. I invite you all to stand. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We pray together. We come again to you, O God, giving you thanks that in this feast of mercy you have embraced us and healed us, making us one in the body of Christ. Go with us on our way. Equip us for every good work, that we may continue to give you thanks by embracing others with mercy and healing. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Before our blessing, since there are only two shopping days left until Pastor Ed's birthday, we can sing to him really quickly. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, Pastor Ed, happy birthday to you. And all can share their personal greetings with him as we go out to serve. And now may God Almighty send us light and truth to keep us all the days of our lives. May the hand of God protect us. May the holy angels accompany us. May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen.
Now go in peace to remember, stand with, and care for the poor.
Thank you for listening to this episode of St. Paul's Lutheran Church's Weekly Worship Podcasts. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.